You know, the Beat Generation was simply a counterculture. Every era has its counterculture.
I was mute, tongue-tied, burdened by shadows and silence.
I read Kerouac and I feel that what he's saying is that he's not looking for a universal meaning to life, but he's saying, fuck you, I'm gonna make my own meaning, and if you don't like it, then kiss my ass.
It's time to make our move.
Want no more than home.
So what is the Beat Generation? Well, the Beat Generation can be categorized as a post-World War II literary movement nestled within small communities in New York City, Los Angeles, and San Francisco. Members of this movement, often entitled Beatniks, express their alienation from square society through avant-garde expressionalism by adopting unique and almost disreputable fashion, manners, and hip vocabulary taken from jazz musicians. To investigate the importance of this generation, a couple of buddies of mine and I decided to assume the roles of these iconic artists and fully assimilate into the North Beach culture. Eli Torgerson, Benjamin Daler, and me, Dante Cokinos. But to fully understand this unique subset of the diverse literary history of San Francisco, we have to understand the conditions that were necessary to spawn such an irreverent and severe artistic societal backlash.
You got to realize World War II provided a lot of opportunity for young men who were not well educated. They were in the cities, many of them were immigrants, and they come back from World War II and all of a sudden they've got the GI Bill, which gave them a loan to buy a house and gave them money to go to college. Nobody had ever seen anything like that before. So you had this rising of the middle class. Unions were big at that time. And so incomes went up, and a man could support a family of four or six or eight people with a job, a 40-hour-a-week job. So it's a different time than it is today.
It was this post-war boom that facilitated the rise of suburbanization and of the nuclear family, which altered societal norms and expectations.
Now, authenticity was not encouraged in the 1950s. You got to remember, this was the age of conformity. 98% of the population did what my parents did, and that became the norm, that became the standard that most people measured themselves by. The Beat Generation, number one, they couldn't conform to that, even if they wanted to, because they were just, for whatever reason, they were different. They were just different.
The Beats were a group of friends that met at Columbia University in New York City that eventually moved to San Francisco. It was this group of friends that pioneered one of the most unique literary movements in American history. Jack Kerouac, writer of the seminal Beat era novel, On the Road. William S. Burroughs, writer of novels such as Naked Lunch, Junkie, and The Soft Machine. Allen Ginsberg, arguably the most influential poet of this era, writer of many poems such as Howl, America, and Kaddish. He was also an early San Francisco gay rights activist. Lawrence Ferlinghetti, writer of many beat-era poems and novels, but most importantly, the co-founder of City Lights Bookstore and Publishers, which became the heart of the beat movement in San Francisco. And Neil Cassady, both an influential figure in the beat and hippie movements, he served as a muse for many of the writers who surrounded and adored him.
The story of Allen and Neil and Jack and Burroughs are young men who were lovers in ways. I mean, Allen, you know, had sex with all of them. Cassady was an abused child. Today we would say Neil Cassady was a homeless boy who became a sex addict because of his life on the streets and the requirements that put upon them. They were the bad boys of the 50s. You know, what Elvis was to music in 1957, what James Dean and Marlon Brando were to film in 1957, Kerouac, Neil Cassady, Ginsberg, they were the literary equivalent of that. They were the people that you'd want to hang out with, you'd want to party with, you'd want to have a beer with, but you didn't want to bring them home and meet your parents because they were on the outside of society.
I saw the best minds of my generation destroyed by madness, starving, hysterical, naked, dragging themselves through the Negro streets at dawn looking for an angry fix, angel-headed hipsters burning for the ancient heavenly connection to the starry dynamo in the machinery of night, who poverty and tatters and hollow-eyed and high sat up smoking in the supernatural darkness of cold water flats floating across the tops of cities contemplating jazz, who bared their brains to heaven under the L and saw Mohammedan angels staggering on tenement roofs illuminated, who passed through universities with radiant cool eyes hallucinating Arkansas and Blake Light tragedy among the scholars of money and war, who were expelled from the academies for crazy and publishing obscene odes on the windows of the skull.
Jazz was the happening scene at the time. Bebop and jazz is what people listened to. And as a result of that, these were the clubs that people would go to. Hey, Charlie Parker's playing, let's go. And they would drive cross country just to see Charlie Parker play. And if you think about jazz as an art form, it's very spontaneous. You know, you might have a trio of guys, and you know, maybe you're playing the horn and he's playing the bass and he's playing the keyboard, and you do your little ensemble, and then you take a solo, you pass it to the bass, he passes it to the keyboard, and then you wrap it up and it's done. All spontaneous. And Kerouac says, why can't you write a book that way? Why can't you live in the moment like that? Why can't you embrace that nowness of that holy moment? It was the spontaneity of the jazz. That's why he calls his writing Bob Spontaneous Prose. Kerouac actually says in On the Road, no more land, said Dean. We can't go no further because there ain't no more land. And Ferlinghetti likes to say, it's almost like the whole history of the country gets shaken up and poured on its side, and all the weirdos come out in San Francisco Bay because we're the end of the continent. The San Francisco's always been welcoming to its strange people.
This is why San Francisco has been home to some of the most progressive movements of the 20th century. So, when a group of slightly homosexual, culture-defying poets settled in San Francisco, they found comfort in a micro-society that represented the same values as them.
The Beats were the tribal elders of the hippies, but they came to embody the face of the city, and their values became San Francisco values, and I would make the argument that San Francisco values have become world values today. People your age consider these values, for the most part, doesn't matter where you live, people who are 15 or 20 years old say and believe, of course gender equality is the way the world ought to be. Of course you treat the girls just like you treat the boys. Of course racial equality is the way it's got to be. All the races are equal. Of course lesbians and gays ought to have civil rights. And of course climate change is a big issue. The Beats would have called it environmentalism. Your age calls it climate change. The whole message of the Beat Generation is about tolerance, compassion for others, and having the courage to live an authentic life. As long as you're not hurting anybody else, come join our party. We don't care who you are, what you look like, what you're into. Just be kind to others and join our tribe.
Who cowered in unshaven rooms in underwear, burning their money in waste baskets and listening to the terror through the wall, who got busted in their pubic beards returning through Laredo with a belt of marijuana for New York, who ate fire and paint hotels or drank turpentine in Paradise Alley Death, or purgatoried their torsos night after night with dreams, with drugs, with waking nightmares, alcohol and cock and endless bulls, incomparable blind streets of shuddering cloud and lightning in the mind, leaping toward poles of Canada and Patterson, illuminating all the motionless world of time between. Peyote solidities of walls, backyard green trees, cemetery dawns, wine drunkenness over the rooftops, storefront burrows of T-head, joyride neon, blinking traffic light, sun and moon and tree vibrations in the roaring winter dusts of Brooklyn, ashcan rantings and kind king light of mind.